Dr. Saraj K. Maher, sir?
Yeah, yeah, I am there.
Okay, fine. We'll start the session, sir.
Yes.
Good morning to Dr. Saraj K. Maher, sir, and all the participants of this 5 days NACT sponsored FTP on artificial intelligence. Today, we have Dr. Saraj K. Maher, sir, as resource person to this FTP. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
I welcome all the participants for the day one Atal FTP on artificial intelligence, organized by the Department of ECE, GSSS IETW. I welcome you all. Before we start the session, I would like to introduce today's resource person, Dr. Saraj K. Maher, sir, to the participants. Dr. Saraj K. Maher, sir, is an associate professor of the System Science and Informatics Unit at the Indian Statistical Institute, Bengaluru. He received the BSc degree in physics from the Sambalpur University in 1990, MSc degree in physics with electronics specialization, and PhD degree in science from the National Institute of Technology, Roorkela, in 1997 and 2003, respectively. He worked as a senior research scientist at research and development units of various industries in India for about 3 years, and was awarded for his excellent contribution in various projects. He was working as a postdoctoral fellow and visiting assistant professor at Indian Statistical Institute, Kolkata, from 2005 to 2006 and 2009 to 2010. He received the Sir J.C. Bose Memorial Award from the IETE India and Orissa Young Scientist Award for research in the field of electronic sciences and technology in the year 2003. And he received 3 gold medals from the Institute of Engineers, Orissa. He is an elected senior member of IEEE. His current research interest includes image processing and analysis, including remote sensing imagery, machine learning, pattern recognition, granular computing, computational intelligence, or soft computing. He has contributed about 50 research papers in the well-known and prestigious archival journals and international refereed conferences and in the edited monograph volumes. It's our honor to have you as resource person for this FTP. Thank you very much, sir, for accepting the invitation to be the resource person, one of the resource person for this FTP. Sir is going to deliver the topic on introduction to artificial intelligence and its application in this session. Participants, to obtain Atal FTP certificate, participant must have 80% attendance. That is compulsory, mandatory, and 60% a test will be conducted at the end of the FTP. Okay, and 60% test mark should be there. Participants need to fill the feedback form in Atal FTP portal. At the end of the day, we will send the attendance link in the Google form and it will be enabled for 1 hour. Participants are requested to fill the attendance form within the given time. If any participants wants to ask questions, they can unmute themselves and ask question, or else you can put the question in the chat box. At the end of the session, the resource person is going to attend the queries. Thank you. Sir?
Yeah, madam.
Okay, over to you, sir. You can take over the session.
Can I share my slides, madam?
Yes, sir. You can, okay. It is audible, sir. And okay. you can share the PPT or presentation. Okay.
Let me share the slides.
Okay, sir. Sir?
Yeah, my slide is visible, I think.
Yes, sir, it is visible. It has to maximize, sir. Yes, it is visible.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much, madam, for a generous and introduction for me. And thank you for giving me a chance to interact with you all. I hope all of the participants are faculty members. Are there any research scholars in this group, audience?
Yeah.
Hello.
Hello, majority are the faculty members.
Okay. They are all from your institute or some outside?
Outside institute, sir.
Okay,
Across
okay.
the India.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
So it's a pleasure actually talking with faculty. You are all my friend kind of thing. So we are all colleagues here. So in between, if any doubts, any concerns, anything if you are having, so don't hesitate and don't wait till the end. You can stop me at that point and I'll try my best to answer that queries. And if not possible, then I may try for the answers and let you know. So the topic of today's discussion is actually there are three sessions are there continuously. Today morning session, afternoon session, and tomorrow one more session. So continuously three sessions for me. I don't know how you will be receiving and how you are going to tolerate me. So I hope things will go in a smooth way, and I'll try my best, and so that things message should be conveyed properly. So at the end there will be some in the last session probably, or last but one, or next session we'll be discussing something on this mathematical basics mathematics. I mean, it's not a deep mathematics, it's a basic mathematics which we have already read in our class 10 or 10 plus 2 levels. So that much mathematics is sufficient, what I should say, to know about, to learn about machine learning, artificial intelligence, and data analysis, and all the things. We'll be talking on those. And but most of the time there is a kind of misconception that we need to be expert in mathematics to work on machine learning's pattern recognition and all the things. But to my experience, I should tell there is nothing like that. Even I am not an expert in mathematics. So whatever is required in machine learning and all this, that much at least I know. And I am also still learning. I am not the expert of this machine learning also. So I am a learner like you. You may say that I am working continuously from last almost 15 years in this particular area. And some level of understanding I have, some level of control I have. So that I would like to share with you all. Hope you will enjoy these sessions. And please let me know if you are having any difficulties in between. So don't wait till the end. So I'm a faculty in Indian Statistical Institute, as I was introduced. So my email ID is this one. If someone is thinking of or any queries or anything related to research and all the things, please drop a word. And I would like to welcome if any of the faculty members would like to have any kind of future collaborations with our group in Indian Statistical Institute. For that, I am welcoming all of you. If you are really interested in this particular area, and it's a fun actually, so you should enjoy that and you should take it as a kind of a pleasure, this discussions. So it's not a study, you can say. You are not learning, you are just going to have an interaction with me. That's it. So the outline of my talk will be something like, it's a very basic one because I'm given the task of giving a kind of introduction to machine learning, introduction to AI, introduction to deep learning, and all the things, pattern recognition. So most of the discussion will be very basic, very preliminary level. And after that, we'll just go to one session for mathematical part. This is basic mathematics, right? And this basic, why we need to have more understanding, or we need to have a control over this basic, is that it's logical actually. See, unless and until we have a strong foundation, what will happen if we build a or if we construct a house on top of that? So you cannot survive for a long period, right? So before working on this machine learning, deep learning, and AI, so many things are there. But to here in this today's discussion, we are not going to talk about any deep level of understanding of this machine learning and all the things, because time is not, first of all, there is no time, and my purpose of coming here and interacting with you is also not this, that one. So we'll just try to, we'll just try to discuss, we'll just try to interact the foundation. I'll try to build a proper foundation so that it will be easier for you for the rest of the sessions of this 5 days FDP program. That is what my belief is. And for everything, we should have a reason for doing that one, right? So directly, we will not go to the any algorithmic part. Most of the time, we will discuss on the basics. We will not go to the algorithmic part. But if time permits, if you are interested, I can go to any level of mathematics or any level of modeling part in machine learning, right? Or in deep learning also. So we'll see that one, how much we can discuss and how much we can move, in what way we are moving, right? So this is how the outline is, what is a machine and systems, then basic working principles, AI, machine learning, deep learning, why it is so, challenges, what is a PR, pattern recognition, what is pattern recognition principle, different types of learnings, and then we'll switch over to the mathematics of machine learnings, okay? So, excuse me, how much time I am allowed on this session? Up to what time? 12:45, 12:15? Hello? Up to what time this session will be? I think 1.5 hour, right? 12:45,
sir.
Okay. So anyway, we'll start with this introductions. What is a machine? Please try to interact with me, okay? And don't assume yourself as your listener and I am the speaker. Don't assume yourself as a student or I am a teacher. It's not like that. So behave like a kind of friend, okay? You are my colleague and I am your colleague. So that's where we can discuss. So please interact so that it will be enjoyable for both of us, for me also and for you also. So the thing is that what is a machine, first of all? Because when we talk about the machine learning, most of the time we don't understand what is machine is all about, right? So in a very basic way, we want to understand what is the definition, what is the principles of working principle of the machine and all the things. A machine is nothing but it's a device which helps us to smoothen our work, which acts as a kind of helping hand to us, right? Helping hand doesn't mean that it is going to replace us. We are the controller. We have that controlling power, right? And machine is not going to take a decision. Finally, we are going to take a decision, but machine is going to help us in taking decisions. So that is that preliminary level of understanding about the machines. So I hope you are understanding what is the definition of a machine, right? So it's a device, it's a systems, it's a model, whatever you say. In machine learning or pattern recognition, we call what is a machine. If you ask me, I would like to say it's nothing but an algorithm. It's a rule. It's a condition. Okay. So that means it is fulfilling some purpose. Whichever is fulfilling some purpose, given a questions, it is providing the output. That is a machine. Whether it is in a form of algorithm level or in a hardware level or software level or whatever it is. So that's the definition of a machine. Okay, now let us go to the next part. So what are the generic systems? How a machine looks like? How it works? I believe all of you are, most of you are belonging to ECE department, Electronics Communication Engineering department, am I right? So I hope you all understand what is, you have also gone through the signal processing, signal and systems, digital signal processing and all the things. And there we have seen what is a system is all about, what is a model is all about, right? We call it in signal processing context, we call it a LTI system, linear time invariant systems, right? So what is the purpose of a linear time invariant system? So I would like to correlate, I would like to correlate this machine learning, what you have already done. You have already done what is a systems, you have already done what is a filter. what kind of filter? It's a fixed filter, a dielectric filter, IR filter, FIR filter, whatever it is. So you all have gone through that process. What is a filter? How to design a filter? What is a systems in communication? What is a channel? What is a, like some problems like that channel equalizations, system identifications, blind deconvolutions, and all the things are there in signal processing and communications applications. You have already gone through that one. So I like to correlate this machine with that system so that things will be very much easier for you to have a control over that one, what is a machine and is all about. And finally, we'll go to the machine learning part. Okay. So in LTS systems, what do we do is that LTS system means in signal and systems, linear time independent systems, it takes some input like XT, okay, and gives the corresponding output YT. Okay. So in LTS systems, we call it a system parameters, HT. Okay. This XT will be processed by the HT, then you are getting YT. Okay. So YT is nothing but XT into HT. And that is not actually the into, we call it a convolution operation. I believe you all know that one. Okay. So output is nothing but processed input. That is what the purpose of a LTI systems. Okay. Exactly same thing happens in meshing also. See, in the first figure, it is written system. The same system, LTI system, in the second figure, what you are seeing, in the first figure, it is also a system. It takes also an input and it gives you the output. Okay. Now, there is a little variations are there. In this LTI system, HT and only systems in the top. What is the difference or variations? There are multiple input and multiple output. Whereas here in single input and single output. So most of the time in signal system and digital signal processing, we deal with single input and single output. Or to be more general way, if I want to say, multi-input, single output. So what I mean by multi-input and single output, that means this XT will be delayed. XT will be delayed for 4 or 5 time instance. So that means XT, XT minus 1, T minus 2, T minus 3. So that means that XT will be delayed to make it as 4 input, but where your output is only 1. Okay. And here in machine, we have multiple input and multiple output, right? Now this one, X1 to XN, is a little bit interpretably different from XT. Different in the sense, interpretations. Processing and functionalities are same. Interpretations, how do you interpret your input? How do you interpret your output? That's what the difference is. Otherwise, there is no difference between a machine, normally whatever in machine learning, what a machine is all about, and a LTI system in signal and systems. Okay. Now, We'll just go to that part a little bit later on. Okay. So there are multiple inputs, multiple hidden variables, and hidden variables are nothing but in your LTI system, we call it a HT, and here it is HK. Okay. System parameters, right? And if we talk about signal system, there are so many systems are there, low pass, high pass, band stop, so many systems are there. We call it a filters. But all these filters are of fixed in nature. They are dedicated for a particular purpose. They don't deviate from their purposes. Whatever that filter is meant for, they do that one. For example, if it is a low pass filter, so it will allow your low frequency informations and it will stop your high frequency informations. If you're a high pass filter, it will allow high pass frequency informations and low frequency component, it will block. Okay. So like that, you have band pass and band stop, right? So we call it a fixed filter. Now this filter has to be adaptive for various applications that you all know. I don't need to repeat that same discussion again. You all understand what is the difference between a fixed filter and an adaptive filter. Now in the fixed filter, your LTI system HT parameters are not fixed. If it is fixed, then it becomes either low, high, band, or band stop. If it is variable, it varies, it changes, then it is called a system which changes itself. We call it an adaptive filter. Now, you all know what is the advantage of adaptive filter over the fixed filter, right? So this is how a fixed and adaptive filter is all about. So the impulse response of a system or filters are changed with respect to your input. And the moment your system parameters changes, it will give you a different kind of output. Now, what for we do that one? Because there are several applications are there where we have a control over your XT, but we don't have a control over your YT. In the sense, what I mean to say is that if you know that what is your task, what is your purpose, what is your input exactly, then there is no difficulty in getting HT. That means you know that you have a task to allow low frequency component. You know that you have a task to allow high frequency component. So everything is dedicated, everything is fixed. So in that case, we don't need adaptive filter. Your HT becomes fixed now. But when your inputs are not under your control, control in the sense there are several parameters are there. You may call it an environmental problem or system problem or hardware or software, whatever problem is all about. So when your XT is not under your control, unexpected XT comes into the picture, then your fixed HT will never work because your HT will provide your YT in a dedicated manner, in a fixed manner. But the moment your XT is changing with a fixed XT, your YT will change. Okay. So your YT will not be the expected YT what you want for. You are expecting something at the output of the system, but you are getting something because your HT are not variable according to your input. Okay. So in that situations, you require a HT which can adapt, which can change itself with some process so that irrespective of your change in input, you are getting exactly YT at the output, whatever you are desiring for. And that is the basic definition of a fixed and adaptive systems. That is what all about filters. Now come to this one applications of this adaptive filter, which will be very much similar to a systems. Adaptive filter working principles. Okay. So what we do in adaptive filter? Sorry. Your Xn is your input, Yn is your output, and adaptive filter, this is your Hn. Okay. So the moment your Xn changes, it may be, you all know why it changes, right? Because in real-time systems, your Xn cannot be a stress, it can be a non-stationary signal, it can be a time invariant, so many problems are there. Okay. So your Xns are unexpectedly changed. So that your Yn will change, okay? But you have a dedicated Yn. That is what we call it a Dn, okay? So what do? We find out the deviations, Dn and Yn. Once the Dn and Yn deviations we get, that is what we call it a En, that is the error, deviations, okay? That En actually goes to the adaptive filter process. And adaptive filter requires this En and Xn to change itself according to your requirement. So what is your requirement here? Your En should be equal to zero. And when your En equal to zero, what does it mean? Dn equal to Yn. That means whatever your system is giving you, you are exactly getting the same thing. So your purpose is fulfilled. That is what the adaptive filter is all about. Okay. Same thing. What do you now is that instead of adaptive filter, you bring this one, this system here. So this becomes your machine learning system. Are you getting my point? So you just replace the adaptive filter block with this system and the whole thing becomes machine learning. I think some noise is coming. Can you please move? Okay. Thank you. So what is the analogy here now?
வெளிச்சம் இல்ல மேம் வீட்லயே லைட் போட்டாலும் அந்த கேமரால அப்படிதான் தெரியுது.
Excuse me.
And I tender in the bill.
Why not clear?
Dr. Shalini ma'am, please unmute yourself. Please mute yourself.
Okay, thank you, madam. So the analogy here is that in machine learning, and see analogy between machine learning and adaptive filter. Okay, so what you would call in machine learning as a machine, that same thing as filter in adaptive filter. Sometimes you call it a system, sometimes you call it a filter, or sometimes you call it a model. Okay, so let us say your problem in the adaptive filter problem is something like that, system identification. So that system is nothing but the filter. Or in machine learning, I will call it as a machine. That is the only basic difference between adaptive filter and machine learning. Okay, now the another variation is that you use a term called adaptive. Your filter is adaptive in nature. That means your filter parameters changes itself. Okay, in machine learning, your machine parameters changes itself. So that is why we call it a machine learning. So whether you talk about filter adaptive or adaptive filter or machine learning, your architecture wise, purpose wise, both are very much similar in nature. So I believe you are in a comfortable zone in understanding what is the variations or what is the difference between adaptive filter and machine learning. Okay. Now let us move to the next one. So motivations, you all know that I have already told. We need to filter information of the signal while its exact frequency information is not known or changes over time. Okay. So there are various problems out there when your adaptive filters are required, because there are several kinds of noise and disturbances comes into the picture. Whether it is a machinery problem or your environmental problem, your noise and disturbance can be additive, multiplicative, so many problems are there. So to eradicate those things, we require adaptive filter. Okay. And its use is something like the problem becomes sensitive. So when you are having non-stationary informations, when you are having time-varying informations, so we require adaptive filters. Anyway, you all know that one. Now coming to this point, so as I already told you, the signal being processed by the filter, that is what you do in adaptive filter. So filter is same as machine and adaptive is same as learning. That is what the basic difference between adaptive filter and machine learning. Okay. Now coming to the, so I'll just not talk about adaptive filter now. Now we'll talk about machine learning, because now you can relate this adaptive filter with the machine learning, because you all know what is adaptive filter is all about, how it works, how it is developed, how you design that one. Okay. Now we'll talk about machine learning and we'll try to relate this machine learning task to this adaptive filter. Because once your machine learning model is done, you can use that one in your adaptive systems and it will work for your adaptive filter also. Okay. Now coming back to this machine learning definitions and the relationship of machine learning with the data and all the things. So the relations between this data and machine learning, you all know what is the meaning of a data. That little bit later I'll just talk about the data, because data is nothing but some kind of numbers. Okay, so information are incorporated in the form of a numbers. Now the question is, why do we require numbers? Why do we require data? Okay, and what is the relationship between the data and machine learning? So as we have already discussed, machine learning actually takes some input, process it, and gives you the output. It is something like that. It's a kind of mapping is happening here. It's a kind of mapping is happening here. What is the mapping? So y is at the output is equal to function of x. Y as the output is equal to function of x. So if I want to say that one, something like this, let me switch to the board. I believe my board is visible to all of you.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So actually what we are doing here is that So this is what the whole basic principle of machine learning. Y is equal to function of X. Now X is your input and Y is your output. That is what you already saw in machines, right? So if it is a machine here, this is your input, this is your output, and this is your H. So the H is nothing but your F. It's a function which works on your input X and gives you the output Y. So it is nothing but a mapping. How this function is mapping your input and output. If that mapping has happened properly, that means you have a control over that one X and one Y. So that mapping is not so easy actually. Mapping in the sense, for each input, I know what is the output. So that is what the meaning of mapping. Okay. So that is the purpose of the machine learning is all about. Now the question is, for all the things, why do we require data? Because here, who is going to work for us? A machine is going to work for us. Machine means any systems, okay, like a computer. Now you all know that a computer or system doesn't understand our languages. Let us see, if I'm telling something to the system or machines, do you think that your machines will work or understand? That means if I tell something to your computer, computer cannot understand that one. So in what way computer can understand? Computer will understand only numbers. But my purpose is to make the computer or the system to work. That means I'm giving some input. I expect the computer or systems should process that input and gives you the output. But when it will happen? When my information as the input will be incorporated in the form of numbers. And that number will go inside the computer. That computer will use some kind of algorithm, okay? Some kind of algorithm, and it will process your input and gives you the output again in the form of numbers. Now again, that number I cannot understand. To make me understand, that output should be again understandable by a kind of interpreter, okay? That number should convey the informations. So this is how a system normally works, okay? So that is why we require data. To make a system or to make a machine work, we cannot interact with them. So data can only interact. So that is why there is a big relationship between data and machines, okay? And that is what the basic link between the data and machine, okay? This learning part is nothing but, don't get confused with the part learning, because learning is nothing but adaptivity. Whatever you are doing in adaptive filter, that adaptivity is here. In machine learning, it's learning. Learning adaptivity means changing. So when machine parameters changes, it is called machine learning. When filter parameters changes, it is called adaptive filter. Okay, same thing. So the machine learning and data, big data, and they are having a big bonding among them. Okay. So as we all know, preliminary way, in a vague way, machine learning is nothing but, it's a kind of procedures, it's a kind of rules, algorithm, which will discover patterns implicit in the data. Okay, that means it is a system which takes the input and according to your requirement, it changes its system parameter and gives you the output. That is what the only machine learning is all about. Now, as I have already told, what is the relationship between machine learning and data? Because without data, we cannot make a machine to learn. We cannot make a machine to work. So that is why data is required. And moreover, data are very bigly available. Okay? So that is why we nowadays call it a big data. But it's a very confusing terminology normally we use, big data. Okay? So what sometimes I used to ask, what do we mean by big data? What is big in big data? Can any of your participants define what is big in big data? Please interact with me. What do you mean by big data? Anybody?
Sir, it's the data which cannot be handled by a normal processor.
Okay, any other definition?
It's basically the data which is huge in terms of the content to be analyzed. For example, if you look into a sales data of a particular region, of a particular store, or of a country, to analyze that data in terms of, you know, a simple, like, what could be the monthly sales.
Yes, yes.
You are basically summarizing a huge individual pieces of data to present or visualize it as a sum of data, or give them a representation, like, you know, for the example, north, south, east and west, this was the sales for this particular product for this month. That is basically big data presentation.
Yeah, let me combine these two definitions in a more general way. So actually there is no specific answer for these questions, like, what if I ask what is big in big data? There is nothing like big here. It's a data. As someone told initially, the data which cannot be handled is a big data. Okay, so in a very simple way, if I want to tell what is the meaning of a big data, the data which I cannot handle. What does it mean? That means the data can be big for me, can be small for somebody else. Okay, it is something like that we call it, right, problem. Let us say I'm giving one problem to you, and I'm asking you, tell me what is the solution of this problem. Let us say somehow you are unable to understand that problem and you are unable to solve that problem. So what do you say then? You normally say, this problem is a big problem for me. We all tell like that. But the moment we can solve the problem, we don't say that this problem is a big problem for me. Same thing is applicable here in big data also. So the data which can be handled, which can be processed, okay, by some means, then that data is not big, irrespective of its size, and all these are there, you all know, right? So irrespective of all the things, only thing we can generalize the definition of the big data is that the data which cannot be processed. That doesn't mean that the data is not at all processed, cannot be processed. It can be processed, but we require some specialized mechanism. Okay. So in that sense, that is how a big data is all about. Anyway, now, as I somehow tell, what is the machine intelligence? We discuss about machine learning. Okay. Initially, we'll discuss about machine learning and how it is related to adaptive filter. Now, there is another term we normally use that is called machine intelligence. Now, this learning term is replaced by intelligence. Okay. So, are they same? Machine learning and machine intelligence, are they same or similar, or they are different? Let us have a kind of understanding on that one. So, first of all, what do we mean by intelligence? What do we mean by intelligence? Intelligence means, normally in a normal scenario, we understand the term intelligence. Let us say, if I want to quantify the term intelligence, then how do we, how shall I do that? I'll use some kind of numbers. Let us say, like, you all are faculties, right? When you are evaluating your students, so you give some marks, okay? Somebody is getting 80% marks, somebody is getting 90%, somebody is getting 70%. And in general, we say that the student who get 90% mark each more intelligent than a student who get 80% mark, because that 90% is bigger than 80%. So you say that the student with 90% is more intelligent than the student with 80%. Now, what I mean by that statement? The meaning here is that, first of all, before going to the term intelligence, let us talk about another term which is called decision. Now, please tell me, why you give a student 90% and why you give another student 80%? Because their decisions are varying. Because their decisions are varying. Decision in the sense, given an input, what kind of output that person is giving? If that output is more appropriate, you give more mark. If that output is less appropriate, you give less mark. Correct? So more appropriate, less appropriate. What does it mean? It means your decision taking ability is better. More appropriate means decision taking ability is better. When your decision taking ability is lesser, you tell less appropriate. Exactly same thing is applicable to intelligence also. If you can take a better decision, then you will be called as more intelligent. If you cannot take a better decision, you will be called as less intelligent. Now, when do you take a better decisions? When do you take a better decision so that you will be called as more intelligent? Just come back to this particular thing. When input is given to the filter and it gives you the output YN, exactly same thing happens what I just now told. I'm asking something and you are answering something. If your answer is more appropriate, you will be called as more intelligent. Now, in that process, what is your adaptive filter here? Your input is what I'm asking. Question is your input. Output is what you are answering. Now, what is your adaptive filter here? When you are answering something, your brain. You all have one brain, right? Some device. As a human being, we all are having one brain, one systems. Okay, which works as a adaptive filter, which works as a machine for us. It takes the input, process it, gives you the output. Exactly same thing your brain does, what your adaptive filter is doing, or what a machine learning is doing. Okay, so your machine takes the input, process it, and gives you the output. Correct? Now, your output is nothing but your YN. And your input is nothing but what I have asked. And your machine is adaptive filter. Now, when do you say that your output YN is more appropriate? When your DN is the exact answer. YN is the approximated answer. Because that approximated answer is coming from your brain. DN is the correct answer. When you are exactly same as DN, you will be called 100% appropriate or 100% intelligent. Whatever deviations you have in this YN from DN, that is called the error. And more is the error, less is the intelligence. Now, how you can increase your intelligence? You see, why I am trying to link this machine intelligence, machine learning with adaptive filter, because you all know what is adaptive filter is all about. I will make you to feel comfortable in working in machine learning. This is nothing but an adaptive filter only. Okay. So when do you call that your system is more intelligent? When YN is equal to DN, that means EN is equal to zero. When this EN will be zero? When this EN will be used to change the system parameter or adaptive filter. Now you tell me one thing. Given a question, when can you give the exact answer? Provided your brain has already learned something. Your brain has received the expertise on that particular problem. Then you can provide a good answers. Now, when it will happen? Let me put one more example. Something like that. Same questions I am asking you, and the same questions I am asking a school student. Now, who can provide a better answer? Obviously, you can provide a better answer compared to that school student. Why? The school student is also a brain. You have also a brain. Why that school student's brain is not able to provide proper answer and when you are able to provide better answer? Because your system has adapted. Your system has learned something which is better than that school student. That is why you are able to provide better answer. Now, what will happen? That will only happen through learning. And learning is nothing but changing the system parameter. What you do in adaptive filter. So this is how a machine intelligence is defined. So machine intelligence, machine learning. Intelligence comes with learning. And learning comes with changing, adaptability. The more adaptive you are, the more intelligence you will be. And that is how a machine learning comes into the picture. Now, what is AI? See, this AI, machine learning, and another term we normally use, deep learning. They are all highly interrelated to each other. Okay. In a normal scenario, we say deep learning is the subset of machine learning and machine learning is the subset of artificial intelligence. Now, in principle of working principle, what is the difference? In artificial intelligence, your system parameter doesn't change. It's something kind of lookup table. information is already there. You are just trying to search where it is. That is what it is called AI. Intelligence is searchable. Your intelligence is not coming by changing the system parameter. So that is why we go to the next level or little bit more specific way of learning. That is called machine learning, where your system parameter changes. It is not like a kind of lookup table. So informations are not already there. You need to discover the informations out of the existing one. And the more generic or more specific one will be your deep learning. And deep learning is, nowadays people are all talking about deep learning and all the things, but it is nothing but the evolution of artificial intelligence and machine learning. Okay. So as I have already defined what is the meaning of the intelligence, intelligence is the generally cognitive problem solving skill, a mental ability which can calculate and which can analyze. Okay. And intelligence is what you do when you don't know what to do. This is a very hypothetical term. You just try to understand what this statement is all about. Intelligence is what you do when you don't know what to do. Given a task, you don't know what should be the answer, exact answer. But under such situation, what kind of appropriate answer you are giving, that is what your intelligence is all about. Okay. So that is, they are all definitions which I have already explained you or defined you. And as I told you, machine learning or machine intelligence, intelligence follows learning. And human intelligence follows learning or adaptivity process. Okay. So now you are comfortable in understanding that particular term, right? Why learning? We all know, to make us intelligent. That is why we learn. If we stop learning, what will happen? We are all learning here, right? You are learning from me, I am learning from you. So there is a process of learning every time. The more you will learn, the more intelligent you will be. And the more intelligent you will be, the better decisions you can provide. So finally, everything boils down to what? Providing decisions. Given a task, what kind of decisions you are giving? So that is what it's all about. Machine learning you talk, or deep learning you tell, or data mining you say, or machine intelligence you say, or sometimes we get data analysis. See, these are all, we say, synonyms. People use the different term in different places conveniently, okay? But finally, you are doing the same thing for all these purposes, for all the terminologies, whatever I just know. But the only difference in learning is that the learning is not learning by heart. So there is a variations in the learning. Either you are understanding and learning, and second is that you, without understanding, you are learning. It is also possible. That is what we call it memorizing. You have memorized the things. You have not learned. You have not understood these things. What you have done? Without understanding, you are just learning through memorizing things. Because you have a good memory power, so you have learned that one by memorizing things. I believe you all understand what is the meaning of memorizing. One best example is that I believe you all have watched the movie Three Idiots, right? So the person who was giving speech on the stage, so what that fellow did? Without understanding, he learned. That means he memorized the things because he had a very good memory power. So that is the problem with learning by heart. So you should learn with understanding, not memorizing the things. Okay, so any computer can learn by heart, but it is difficult to generalize. So learning by heart is easier actually. Okay, it's a good thing that you have a good memory power, but it is not always good actually. Because when you have ability to memorize something, you don't feel to learn that one. You don't feel to understand that one. So what do you do? Without understanding, you start learning. And that is what we memorize the things. And that creates a lot of problem in future to take any kind of decisions. So when learning is used, expertise doesn't exist always. Okay. So where you learn, because you want to be expert in that particular domain. Already experts are not available. You want to make yourself expert in that one. expertise may not be explained practically. Okay, solution changes in times. Today, for the same problem, I have one solution. Tomorrow, I will have another solution for the same problem. Okay, solution needs to be adapted to a particular class or particular cases. Because every time your scenarios are changing, although your input is same, your scenarios are changing. So when your scenarios are changing, your output will vary. Whatever you are expecting, you will not get. Sorry. So we discussed the relationship between big data and machine learning. Okay. So as I told you, there are various kind of V's are there in big data analysis. That is how we define the big data. For all the things, machine learning is helpful, because there are certain situations where our human being doesn't work. We may not be able to, we are not in a position to provide the solutions. So what we expect, we expect somebody should help me. And that somebody is nothing but your machine. Okay. So whether you learn or machine learns, the same thing. So how can you make a machine to learn? That is what the whole purpose of machine learning is all about. Okay. So something like this, some applications like this. So it is the surface of some kind of moon or some planet where a machine is sent. Okay. Now, is it possible for a human being to go to that place and take the data or analyze this information or provide the information, whatever it is there on that surface? It is not possible. So what is the best way we can do? We can send a machine. We can send a machine to that surface, moon surface or any planet surface. And what we can do? We expect that machine will provide informations after analyzing that information to us, so that we will have a better understanding about that particular locations. Now, when it will happen? Do you think that only just sending a machine there will solve the purpose? No. We should send a machine to that particular locations who can take a decisions like a human being. Who can take a decisions like a human being? The meaning is that we will send a machine as if we are sending a human brain to that place. We are sending a machine assuming that that machine will function similar to a human brain. So that means whether we send a machine or a human being, there is no difference. Okay, because sending a human being is not practically feasible at this point of time. So only feasible way is that you send a machine. You make the machine in such a way that you design the machine in such a way that it will behave, it will analyze, it will process the informations like a human being. So there is no point in sending the human being there. Okay. So that is why a machine learning is highly applicable there. Okay. So you can understand, you are assuming that your machine is behaving like a human brain. How difficult the task is. So to some extent, we have already done that one, and we have not yet reached to that level where we can develop a artificial human brain. Okay, and that is the final target of the machine learning community. Okay. So anyway, these are all the things which we have already discussed and experienced that one, and how a machine is highly helpful for most of the cases. And whether it is in the telecom department, or telecom domain, or medical domain, or any astronomy, remote sensing analysis, in so many places, in health or domain. Okay, so we need the helping hand, and that is what the machine is all about. I believe live examples I can give here, something like that. Let us say you are going to a doctor, Okay, you are having some health problem and you are going to a doctor. And once you start telling the doctor you about your problem, before giving any answers by the doctor, what the doctor normally does? Doctor normally asks for several lab tests. Okay, so several lab tests the doctor normally asks before providing or before giving you any kind of prescription or any kind of solution. Now, do you think that the same thing was happening 20 years back or 30 years back? It was not happening. Those days also human beings were there. Those days also doctors were there, and those days also patients were there. Now, what is the difference between those days doctor and present day doctor? Can we conclude something like that? The present day doctors are less intelligent than those previous day doctors. Because previous those doctors, 30 years back doctors, they were not using many lab reports to perform the diagnosis and understand the symptoms and all the things and provide the solutions. By just heartbeat, through your heartbeat or your normal visible symptoms, the doctor could able to provide the solutions. Then why present-day scenarios, the doctors are not able to do that? Do you think that these present-day scenarios, doctors are less intelligent? Sorry? Do you have any answers for that? What is your answer? Present-day doctors are less intelligent than 30 years back doctors? Anybody?
No, sir. They are, most of them are depending on the test reports.
Yes, present day scenarios it is happening, right? But 30 years back it was not happening. So my question is, why those doctors are more intelligent, those earlier days doctors, than the present day doctors?
No, sir.
What is this? Why it is happening then? So now doctors are more dependent on machines.
Yes, sir.
Lab reports means machines, right? So machine is providing some answers, and on the basis of those answers, they are providing the solutions. So what is happening here? So the easiest way, if I want to answer this particular questions, I would like to say, it is nothing like that earlier days, 30 years back, doctors were more intelligent than the present year doctors. Present generation doctors are not less intelligent. They are equally intelligent than compared to those 30 years back doctors. Probably they are more intelligent than those 30 years back doctors. But why, if they are more intelligent, then why they are taking the helping from a machine? Because the problem has become more complex. The problem has become more complex. The scenario has become more uncertain. The environment has become more randomness. So many uncertainties, so many problematics, so many variations are problems are there. Today you are going to a doctor, you are having some fever, and you are going to a doctor and you are describing yourself that, yes, I am having a fever. Now this, just try to imagine the same scenario 30 years back. When 30 years back, there was hardly one or two kind of fever were there. But today, if you go and tell the doctor, I have a fever, there are n number of possibilities of fevers are there. You all know what I mean to say. Okay? You may be a dengue fever, you may be this fever, you may be corona fever, you may be that viral fever, 100 types of viral fevers have come up, which was not there 30 years back. That means that problem was not so complex those days. So that is why they were not requiring any complex systems or any kind of helping hands. For some complex problem, they are also taking the help, but not in general way. But today, even for a small problems like fever, which is very common in our health systems, the doctor asks for several tests. Okay, so the system has become more and more complex. So that is why we require a helping hand. And that is, who is helping us? Machine is helping us. But at the same times, we cannot say that machine is going to overtake human being. Machine is going to replace human being. No, it is not possible. Till today, it is not possible. I don't know about the future. Till today, it is not possible. Machine is only helping us, not giving the final decisions. Okay. So this is how a machine works. As I have already shown this figure earlier to you. So broadly, there are three kind of learnings happens in machine learning. Okay. Supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. There is another kind of learning we normally call it a semi-supervised learning. We will just little bit discuss about these four kind of learning to some extent, then we'll just switch over. Okay. Now let us talk about, we have already discussed many advantages of machine learning. Okay, in what way they can help us. One basic advantage what we have it will help us to take a better decisions. Okay. Now, let us talk about some of the challenges, issues in machine learning. Don't think that machines are always correct and it is very easy to operate. And it is very easy to model. Okay. So it is not like that. There are several issues are there. Some of the issues I have just listed out here. For example, what algorithms can approximate functions well and when? See, if you remember, I was showing on that board y is equal to f of x. That means y is nothing but the function of x. X is your input, y is your output. And what is the purpose of f? It will try to map that function f, try to map between input and output. The moment that mapping happens, then your job is over. Okay, now how to do that? Mapping is not so easy. That the wording mapping looks like very easy. Okay, that mapping means your input is getting mapped to the output. Okay, so that function mapping or approximating the function's parameters, that is what we call it algorithm. How shall we approximate that functions? What kind of algorithm we should use? Okay. So that is not clearly known, because given a task, we will never know from the beginning what kind of algorithms we should use. There exist n number of algorithms. Which one to choose? Because not all algorithms will work similarly for the same problem. They work differently for different problems. Okay. How does number of training samples influence accuracy? See, these training samples means the learning materials. The learning materials which helps to learn or to train a machine. See, let us say you are learning something. So who is going to help you to make you learn? Your learning material, through learning material only you will learn. Correct. So those things are called training examples. Now, it is not always true that whatever learning material you are using, those will be the best training materials. Is it there? Is there anything happens? No. There are n number of training materials are there. You are learning from those training materials which are available to you. That doesn't mean that that is the best training materials. Now the problem comes if you are not using a proper training materials. That means you are not learning properly. And if you are not learning properly, your output will deviate. Your decisions will not be more appropriate. So everything is linked to your learning materials. Now, who will give me the best learning materials? That is the problem. Okay. How does complexity of hypothesis representation impact it? How does noisy data influence accuracy? What are the theoretical limits of learnability? See, when you are learning something through a learning material, do you think that your learning material information are the most accurate one? Why you are telling that your learning materials are not accurate one? Because the informations are noisy. The informations are not pure. So when you are learning from an impure material, your learning will not be perfect. And if your learning is not perfect, your decisions will vary. So that is why the noise influence is very much plays a very important role in taking decisions. So you need to take care of that one. Okay. So how can systems alter their own reports? There are several things are there. Let me not go to that one. So what are the best tasks for a system to learn? The meaning here is that how do you select which system should work for a particular problem? It is not always true that all system will work perfectly for all problems. For human being also it happens, right? We don't want to be the jack of all trades. We want to be master of one domain. Do you want to be a jack of all trades? No, we don't want. What do we want? We want to be master of a particular domain. Now, same thing if we want to incorporate in a machine for a given task, how do we decide which system parameter or which machine will work properly for that particular task? Who will tell me? Who will help me? So all these problems are there while developing a machine learning algorithms. Because all the things also you are also facing when you are taking a problem. That means when your brain is taking a providing a solutions, your brain also faces the same problem. Okay. So broadly, some issues are something like on the modeling part. How do you model a system? How do you modeling means? How do you have a control over that mapping, that function part? How do you control over that system parameters? Okay, that is what the meaning of the modeling or learning. Okay. So there are several applications are there. So I'll not go to that one. Modeling, representation algorithms, all are very much useful to develop a good learning algorithms. Okay. So what can we summarize here? The message here is that it's a mapping, that function of X is equal to Y. Okay, so that mapping has to be done properly. And we also learned that three major factors successfully makes a machine learning model. What is that? Much data. Much data in the sense, you should learn more and more. You all understand. See, let us say you are talking about a particular syllabus of your, any kind of syllabus of your curriculum. Okay. Now you all have seen that in that syllabus, there is a textbook is there and there are some reference books are there. Okay. Now somebody may ask, when textbook is there, why do I require reference book? When there is a textbook for that particular syllabus, why do I require reference book? So reference book will actually provide a kind of broader knowledge or broader information about your input. So that is where the much data. More is the information, better is the learning, better is the understanding. So more data is always desirable. But more data doesn't mean that any data. More good data, pure data, which contains better information. Sometimes what happens, you know, information is there in your data, but you are not understanding that data. So it is not the problem of the data. It is the problem with you because you are not able to understand the data. So you just try to understand what are the different kind of uncertainties are there to develop a good model. Another one is the well-suited learning algorithm. How do you learn? How do you learn? Because no one can explain properly how someone learns. If you ask me also, how do you learn? I'm not in a position to tell that exactly how my brain learns. So which one is the best way to learn? Okay. So all these things are there which actually helps to develop a good machine learning models. Okay. So the final understanding is, most important is your understanding. Why I am telling here is that most important is your understanding, because your understanding means you should have some kind of intuitions about your output. You should have some intuitions about your output, what you desire for, what you are expecting from the systems. It is not that some informations are there, you are closing your eyes and jumping to this information in the form of a data and you are trying to get the solution. It will never happen. Okay. So you should have a kind of intuitions about your input, You should have a intuitions about your output, then only you can develop a good models. Okay, that is where your intuition power and experience matters. Okay. So as we have already discussed, while learning from data, because data are cheaply available, plentifully available. Okay. But we need to think about that one, that which data is more suitable for my problem. Okay. So a good and useful approximation to the data is very much required. So at the same time, I would like to say that there is no free lunch available. The meaning here is that for a particular problem, you developed a solution. Okay. Or at the same time, if I want to say you are expert in a particular domain. Now, if I ask you a question from a different domain, can you answer that? It will not be possible. Same thing also applicable to a system modeling. If you have developed a model for a particular problem, don't expect that that model will work across the domain and across the problems. So generally speaking, no model works the best for all possible solutions. Are you understanding that this particular statement? No model works the best for all possible solutions. Because you cannot be expert in all possible domains. You can only expert in a particular domain. That is what we want also, okay? Now you may have a kind of queries, why not traditional analysis? Because the amount of information is very large. In the form of the data, if you want to say, the tremendous amounts of data are there. Which data to take, in which format you have to take, no one knows. For a particular problem, what kind of data is required, no one knows. So to select and understand the data in a proper way, it's a very difficult task. High dimensionality of the data, high complexity of the data, all the things matters, okay? And that is why we cannot trust on the traditional analysis. Now the same thing you can ask, why not human data analysis? Because we have already understood that human brain is the ultimate intelligent model one can ever think of. When that is the scenario, why do I require a helping hand? Why do I require a helping hand? Helping hand means a machine. Why I want a machine to work for me? Why I want a machine should work like a human being? When I know that my human being, me as a human being or any human being has a very efficient decision-taking systems, your brain is the most intelligent systems on the earth. Do you believe this or not? We all believe that. Yes, human brains are the most intelligent brain and it can take the most intelligent decisions. If that is the scenario, why do I require machines to help me? Because there are certain limitations of human beings are there. And the limitations are very, preliminary level, if I want to say, important decisions are made by a human being on the information rich data stored in the database, but not rather in the decision maker's intuitions. The meaning here is that you should take a decisions not based on decision maker's intuitions. You should take a decision based on the information present in the data. What is your intuition is telling, you should not always follow to that particular directions. Human experts are prone to biases and errors. This is always true for human being. The biasness and the errors. We as a human being commit so many errors, so many biasness are there. Our biasness comes from, you know what, from where? Our emotions, our feelings. So emotions, feelings, all are there in a human brain. And these emotions and feelings actually makes us to commit errors because we are biased to a particular scenarios. Second thing, it is extremely time consuming and costly. Getting a human expert is not so easy. So these are all the problems are there which motivate us to go for a machine analysis, machine based data analysis. Okay. So the prerequisite for a machine learning are something like that. We must have confidence on what tasks to be learned and what knowledge we need to understand. How do we represent the knowledge? How do we represent the information? And all these problems are there. Okay. Now the question, the basic questions will come when machine learning is not required. Or in the same way, if I want to say in the context of human learning, why a human learning is not required? That means, when do you feel that I don't need to learn anymore? I am sufficient enough to provide the decisions. Is there such scenario in the human environment? Do you think that such kind of situations will come to you at some point of time that you may say that I don't need to learn anymore? That situation will never come. So same thing I can tell that when machine learning is not required, that means when learning is not required for a machine, the answer will be when the relationship between all system variables is completely understood. As I was giving you y is equal to function of x, if you know the relationship between x and y, you know the mapping then f, and the moment you know the mapping f, you don't need to learn anything. And in most real-time scenario, this is not the case. Your environment keeps on changing, your noise value changes, your system parameter changes. So many external factors or parameters are there which makes your input more and more uncertain, more and more noisy. And because of that reason, you require learning. Learning is must to provide a good decisions, whether it's a human being or a machine. Okay. So applications are very broad, actually. There is no specific applications of machine learning are there. So they are diverse and generic also. Okay. So broader visualizations of machine learning that we have already seen in many places. So machine learning is a core concept of various advanced technologies with pattern recognition and learning. Now we'll just come to the pattern recognition. What is that pattern recognition is all about? Because it's a subset of, again, machine learning. So which will make us to understand how a machine works, how a machine learns from the data. Okay. Now, coming to the pattern recognition systems. Okay. So before that pattern recognition systems, I would like to tell what a data is all about, how a data set looks like. So that, see, better understanding about the data gives you a better modeling of the system. And better is the modeling of the system, better decisions you can provide. So everything boils down to proper understanding about the data. If you have not understood the data properly, there is no point to go beyond that stage. You are not understanding data means you are not understanding the information. You are not understanding information means your input is not understood by you. Now, can your brain provide a proper output without understanding the input? It is not possible, right? So your brain has to understand the input as much as possible, as accurate as possible. So the moment your brain can understand your input properly, it can provide you the decision appropriately. So understanding data is much important in the development of a systems or a machines. Okay. So what is a data object and pattern is all about? So before that one, let me just explain a little bit what is a pattern recognition system is all about. Okay. Now, as I told you from the beginning, intelligence comes with learning, okay, and learning comes with adaptivity, and that adaptivity you provide based on the kind of decisions you take, based on the kind of decision you take. So now what I'm trying to say is that everything boils down to provided decisions. Everything boils down to provided decisions. Decision means given a problem, you are providing some output. That is the meaning of decision is. Okay. So if your output is correct, your decision is correct. If your decision is correct, you are more intelligent, your model is working fine, and you are having a good understanding about your input. Okay, so everything boils down to the decisions. Now, have you understood how a decision's being taken? How a decision is being taken by a human brain? So if I ask you how your brain works, can you tell me how your brain works? Because your who takes a decision for you? Your brain takes a decision for you, correct? Now, given input, your brain processes it and gives you the output. Like the way we have seen, right? Your y is the function of x. Your app is nothing but your machine or system parameter, okay? So given input, you are getting output. And your output is nothing but your decisions. So when your output will work properly, I mean, when your output will be more accurate, if you can map your input to the output properly, okay? So what I mean to say is that when you are taking decisions, you follow some procedures. Let me talk about our human brain working principles. When your human brain takes some input, that input is getting processed by your brain, it provides the output.
Sir, sorry to interrupt you, sir. Your screen is not visible, sir. Are you not sharing the PPT, sir?
No, it is shared.
No, it is visible. It is visible. We can see. You have to pin to that sir's account.
Okay.
Okay, it's visible, right? Okay.
And some of the participants are saying that. So, participants, please pin the screen.
Okay. So, it is visible to all of you, right?
Yes, it is visible. Okay.
So, when you your brain takes a decisions, it follows certain procedures. Okay? And that procedure is called pattern recognition procedures. Or pattern recognition principles. Okay. Now, just imagine how a brain takes the input and provides the output. So don't think that your brain takes the input and instantly gives you output without processing. No. It follows certain procedures, and that procedure is nothing but pattern recognition systems or pattern recognition principles. How it happens? See, it has three steps of operations. See, one step is called measurement space, feature space, and decision space. Okay, so here at the input, you provide your input. The moment you provide your input, it goes to the measurement space. From measurement space, it goes to the feature space. And from feature space, it goes to the decision space. And after decision space, your decisions comes out. Here your output. Left side is the input, right side is the output. This is what a system normally follows while giving the decisions. Exactly, your brain also works in a similar way. So let us try to understand what happens in measurement space, what happens in feature space, and what happens in decision space. So can I take for 5-10 minutes before going to the launch?
Yes, sir. You can continue, sir.
Okay. Up to 1 o'clock, we'll have a discussion, then we'll have after lunch session.
Okay. Thank you.
So before understanding this measurement space, feature space, and decision space, let us first understand how a data is all about and what is the understanding about the data. Okay. So first thing is that what is a data object or pattern? You might have heard about this term, right? You might have heard about the data. You might have heard about the term object and pattern. Okay. Before going to the understanding about the pattern, there is another term we normally use that is called trend. T-R-E-N-D, trend. So the trend is having a different meaning compared to the pattern. This trend and patterns are not same. So in another way, if I want to tell what is a pattern is all about, pattern is actually related to object. Now, if I ask you, what do you mean by object? You may answer something like this. Whatever I am seeing with my eyes on this earth is an object. Correct? Whatever I can see with my eyes on this earth is an object. So if I want to make more generalized definition of an object, what does it mean? Or how do I define that one? An object is nothing but something which has some expression. An object is something which has some expression. Expression in the sense, it has some characteristics, it has some behavior. Let us say there is a pen with you. Let us say there is a pen with you. Pen means writing pen. Okay. So if I ask you, you tell me what is this object is. It's an object. Your pen is also an object. Okay. Now if I ask you, you tell me what is this object is all about. You will quickly say this object is called pen. Now how you got that answer? Because this is an object and it has some characteristics or it has some observations. What are those observations? Its length, breadth, width, size, shape, color. So these are the expression of that particular object. So anything, whatever you are seeing with your eyes, can be called as an object if it expresses itself. Now, is there anything which you see and cannot be called as an object? There is nothing like that. So that means everything has some expression for itself, whether it's a table or chair or human being or a pen or a pencil or anything, whatever you are seeing with your eyes can be called as an object because it has some expression. Expression means it has some description. It can describe itself by these parameters. So in pattern recognitions or in machine learning or in data mining, the pattern means nothing but the same thing as object. So whatever we are seeing with our eyes can be called as a pattern. Then we can define the pattern in something like that. Anything which has some observation, some expression, is a pattern. So a pattern is nothing but a set of observations. So anything, whatever you are seeing, is a pattern. For example, like your handwriting is a pattern, your fingerprint is a pattern, your number is a pattern, you yourself is a pattern, the pen is a pattern, anything, any object, whatever you are seeing with your eyes is a pattern because everything has its own expression. So there are several examples I can give you what is the meaning of a pattern. See, anything can be called a pattern. Your face is a pattern, your eyes is a pattern, your hand is a pattern, your name is a pattern, you yourself is a pattern. Okay, you are understanding what the meaning of a pattern is. So these are all the definition of a pattern. So I'm quickly just skipping those things. Example of pattern. Anything, whatever you are seeing with your eyes can be called as a pattern because it has its own expression. Okay. So all objects are having their own expressions. Fine. Biological pattern, musical pattern. face pattern, chemical pattern, brain pattern. So different variations, these are the different pattern. We call it a texture sometimes. So like that, there are various patterns out there. Chemical pattern, telecom pattern, there are optical characters pattern. So anything, whatever you are seeing can be called as a pattern because all are having expressions. Now we use some term for this expression and that is called attributes or features. So what is a pattern now? If we want to define a pattern is nothing but a set of attributes. For example, this you just see the table here. This table has some number of rows and some number of columns. Okay. Now each row, I can call it as a pattern. And each column, I can call it as a features or attributes. So that means I can call this whole table as one database. This is how my database looks like. So given this database, you are going to develop a model. So first thing is that you need to understand that model. You need to understand the data. So how to understand this data? I can understand the data with its specifications. What are the specifications? This data set has 10 number of rows. I can say this data set has 10 number of patterns. Each pattern has 4 number of features because 4 number of columns are there. But there are how many columns are there? 5 columns are there. Why I'm telling 4 columns are there? Because the first column doesn't provide any information. So anything which is not providing any information, I cannot tell this thing as a expression or a attribute or a feature. So anything which provides some level of information about this object or a pattern, I can call them as attribute or features. So you can see in this database, each row contain four features: refund, marital status, taxable income, and cheat. So these are the four features we have. Okay, and on these four features, we are going to develop a model. So if I want to say what is the specific example of the data set, this data set has contained, this data set contains 10 number of pattern, and each pattern contains four features. It is done now. Now you develop your model. Okay, so that is how a data set is understood. Now, but there is a small more understanding about the data is required here. You see, some informations are character format and some informations are in numerical format. Like your cheat. Cheat is no, yes is there. Taxable income, this is in numbers. Marital status, these are all characters. Again, refund, these are all characters. Now, you all know that there are various way to represent the informations. I can represent the information in terms of number. I can represent the information in terms of characters also. But this is not the problem of a human brain. The problem, this is the problem with a machine, you know, because machine has a different interpretation for numbers and different interpretation for character. For a machine, if you provide the data set which contains all numbers in nature, it is easier for the machine to understand and work on it. But it is not always true that you will get a database which contains only numbers. It may contain characters also. So we call it as a heterogeneous data set, which contain both numerical features and which contain categorical features. Okay, so features, values are different, but features, names are same. Like let us say refund, marital status, taxable income. These are called feature name or attribute name. And this value, yes, no, they are different. Okay, this is how a pattern or object and attributes are defined. So likewise, we can have different attributes like nominal attributes, binary attributes, ordinal attributes. So let me not go to that part. So in that way, you will have a different kind of data sets. You can have a record data, you can have a data metrics, document data, transaction data, graph data. So these are the different kind of data which you are collected from different domain. Because you are as a data modeler, who is going to model the data, you need to understand that data in an appropriate way. You should understand where from the data has come and what that data represents. A proper understanding about the data will lead to a proper development of the model and proper solutions. Okay, so try to understand the data first in a proper way. These are called the sequence data, the genome data, bioinformatics data. Okay, so this is called the genomic sequence data. You know, you are understanding nowadays about this kind of characters. Normally we are seeing in TV news now, the present scenarios of COVID-19, we used to call it a mutations. So genomic sequence of this coronavirus, so these are the called sequence data. So this technicians, the data scientists, along with the domain expert, with the doctors, they work together and try to find out in which point that mutation is happening in your coronavirus or something like that. Okay. And if that mutation means changing of that one, let us say your C becomes A, A becomes G, G becomes A. So these are all, we can, in pattern recognition, we call it as a kind of changing of the feature value. My pattern is same, but changing the feature value. So I can tell that your genomic sequence data or your, see, yesterday or day before yesterday, we heard that there is a vaccine came for the coronavirus. What does it mean then? Because people could understand this sequence. And the moment you can understand the sequence, you can develop that particular remedies. Okay, so this is the collaboration of the data scientists along with the doctors. Okay, so that is why the role of pattern recognition is very large and very dynamic in nature. So the more efficient way you can develop a pattern recognition model or machine learning, the efficient output you can get. You may say that, had we developed a pattern recognition and machine learning model in a more efficient way, in a more faster way, we could have get the vaccines much earlier than
sir PPT is not visible, sir.
My slide is not visible.
No sir, it is difficult to understand.
sir it is visible.
Visible for some people, it is not visible. I don't know.
Sir, you have to
feel. Slide is visible, sir.
I see.
So, can you explain us how to ensure the what you are presenting is seen on our this one?
Yeah, just I am explaining. See, now this slide is visible to all of you.
No.
Sir, it's visible.
Yes, sir.
It's visible. Visible.
Can you help us with the settings? How to?
Not visible.
But how can I help you? I'm sorry, I cannot help you in this in a, because some people are
taking classes with two ID. So one is audible and one is for presentation. So please, participants, if you are not seeing the PPT, go through the slides and pin the screen. Then it's visible.
Ma'am, can you explain how do you do that, please? Because we have not been used this app previously. We were using Microsoft Teams. Can you explain us how it is done here?
Sir, there is a layout. No, you can see all the participants together.
Yes.
So there only one PPT slide source will be seen. No. So there's one. If you click on that, there is pin to screen button is there. Can you see that pin to screen?
One second, ma'am.
There's a pin kind of icon. You have to click on that pin to screen.
Okay. Let me do it. One second. Yeah. Yeah, I've pinned it.
So you can see his screen.
And now is it visible?
One second, sir. It's not yet showing up.
I think you need to pin to me actually. There is a pin on pin and pin will be there. You need to pin to me to my screen.
One second.
My audio is really visible, I believe.
Yeah. Now it is better. So I think yeah. Your audio is good. Now you are able to see your screen. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So let me just tell you one more time what is the genome sequence data and all the things. See, 2 days back we heard that the vaccine has come for the coronavirus, right? So how did they get the solutions? Solution means the vaccine is a solution for the problem. Problem was the virus, and the solution was how to kill that virus. Now, how that virus normally comes into the picture in our body? They come in a genome sequences. Okay, you might have heard about this something like that original coronavirus and different strains of coronavirus. So that strains comes actually during the mutations. Okay, so we call it a UK strain, UK mutated virus, Europe mutated virus, South Africa mutated virus. Something like that. So what is happening there? So the moment it goes to our body, that genome sequence, you see, you are able to see right there, GG, TT, CC. They are the numbers or characters normally the doctors and people are using to represent a sequence of genomes. Genome is our gene sequence. Okay. So the moment it changes, that mutation changes, You can call that it has developed a new virus. Okay. Now, what is a virus is all about? Virus is nothing but it's just, see, there are so many sequences you are seeing, like GG, TT, CC, GG, all the things are there. So each of them is nothing but one component of a gene. So I can call it as a kind of one pattern. I can call this as a pattern. And each character is nothing but one features. So the whole problem becomes pattern recognition problem. The whole problem becomes pattern recognition problem. Now the thing is that how do I recognize in which locations does gene character changes itself? So if I can find a solution to that one, then I can find a vaccines also. So this is how a solution comes out. So you can think that why people have already got vaccines 1 month back and why we got late, because they have more advanced technologies to use the patternization principles in a better way. So that is why they got the solution very early than us. So these are all depends on how you develop a model, taking the input uncertainty and provides you the output. Okay. So this is how it happens. So what is a database? As I told you, this is database is nothing but the database looks like, these are all databases. What kind of data you are having from different domain, these are called database. Okay. So now I'll just go to this database and data mining. There are certain differences are there. So, okay. So I'm just skipping that part particularly because I believe you are understanding what is the difference between a database and data mining. Just definition wise, if I want to say, in database, you say it's a list of items which are already there in your table. Only thing is that you need to look for that one. You need to search for that one. That is what we call a database management. You are managing the data set in such a way that it can be searchable proper way. You know exactly what you are looking for in database. That means your output is already there in your database. That is what we call database management. Then what is data mining? See, don't get confused with the term data mining. Data mining is same thing as pattern recognition, which is same thing as machine learning. So what is a data mining or pattern recognition is about? You know a vague information about what you are looking for. Vague information means a intuitive information. And through these intuitions, you are searching for the information. That means exactly the information or output is not available in your database, but a kind of intuition, some kind of information is getting discovered. That is what the meaning of pattern recognition or data mining. Okay. So something like that, let us see if I want to give some examples, something like that. The query examples, let us say in the database, there is a database of bank database or insurance database is there. So somebody is asking, find all credit applicant with last name of Smith. That means that answer is Smith, which is already there in the database. So only thing is that you need to search that particular answer within this database. That is what we call it a database management. Then what is a data mining? Find all credit applicant who are poor credit risk. You are getting the difference between these two questions. First questions were deterministics. Answer is already there in the database. You are just trying to search that. But the second query is find all credit applicant who are poor credit risk. This answer is not there in the database, but you are discovering this information from the database, and that is what the pattern recognition, data mining, or machine learning is all about. Okay, so this is what I I'm just skipping this part. So shall we go for the lunch, and after lunch we can again start, or you want to stay for some more time? I'm ready to do that. If you want to go for lunch, then also I'm ready for that. So which one will be more convenient for you? Shall we stop here or continue for another 10-15 minutes? Can anyone respond? Shall we stop here or continue for 10-15 minutes more?
So we can come back after lunch, sir.
Okay. So we'll stop here, then we'll come after lunch. Okay. Okay. So what time we should come back? 1-2 o'clock, huh?
Yes, sir, 2 o'clock.
We should come at 2 o'clock, right?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, we should come back at 2 o'clock, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we'll go for lunch and we'll come back at 2 o'clock.
Sir, completed, sir. AI and its application session.
No, the second session is also introduction to machine learning and AI, right? I combined these two sessions. I mean, I didn't segregate that as it is introduction of AI and this is introduction of AI. So okay. I just combined these two sessions.
Okay, sir. So we'll take a break for lunch. Before that, before going for lunch, we'll take the group photo, sir. All of you must turn on your video for group share, group photo. Participants are requested to turn on your video for group photo.
You want me to switch on the video?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
My video is projected to the screen, so.
Okay. Students, participants are requested to turn on your video for group photo.
Are you visible now?
Yes, sir. You are visible, sir. Thank you, participants. Thank you. We'll take a break for lunch. Participants are requested to join the session 2 at 1:55. Link given for the first session. Okay, we'll send the link again. Thank you. Hello.